And the next talk will be given by Professor Sergey Nikolaevich Gavrilov from Institute for Process in Mechanical Engineering.
This is the title of my presentation. First of all, about the motivation. The motivation was the presentation at a previous APM conference. This is presentation by Sokolov, Krentsov, and Muller, and the title was heat conduction in one-dimensional harmonic crystal, finite or infinite, the comparison of two approaches. And in that presentation, they were considered the problem related to heat propagation in one-dimensional harmonic crystal or Hooke's chain. This problem can be formulated in the following form. You can see this schematic for the Hooke chain. This is the equation for Hooke chain. Here we have initial condition. The first initial condition is zero, and the second initial condition is non-zero for one particle, zero particle. This is a random initial condition. The initial value for the velocity is random, rho is random quantity. The expectation for this random quantity is zero, and the variation is one. There are two approaches to this problem. The first approach is classical discrete approach, exact approach, and it is known for us mostly due to studies by Schrödinger, by Crane, Prigozhin, and by Hemmer. This is quite old studies. The exact solution for this problem obtained mostly by Schrödinger in 1914. This is the solution, the expression for the velocity. In fact, this solution can be obtained in very easy way by applying the discrete time Fourier transform to the equation of motion. The solution has the following structure. And expressed via the following form, where we have the Bessel function of order 2n squared, and this Bessel function depends on Daubert time. The second approach is known for us mostly due to studies by Professor Krentsov and his colleagues. There are some studies, and this approach is continuous. This is approximate approach, and this approach is based on some consolidation procedure. In the case of 1D harmonic crystal or Hooke chain, this approach leads to the following equation for the kinetic temperature. This equation can be solved, and the solution can be expressed in the following form. So we have the following continuous solution. What are advantages of the continuous approach? First of all, this approach can be generalized to the case of two-dimensional or three-dimensional and/or polyatomic lattices. And this approach can be generalized to the case of heat supply and take into account the dissipation. This approach allows us to get analytical solutions for these complicated cases, and the only requirement that we need to have enough smooth initial conditions. And a little bit, what is continuization? Continuization is enough complex procedure. Initially, we have the initial equation formulated in the form of an infinite system of stochastic or random order differential equation. Then we, in general case, if we have stochastic equation, use eta lemma to derive the infinite system of deterministic order differential equations. Then we apply the continualization, and derive the infinite set of linear partial differential equation for covariance variables. Then we drop the higher order term derivative in the equation for covariances and get the infinite systems of partial differential equations describing the slow motions, which are related to the heat propagation. And at this step, in the simplest case of the hook chain with special initial condition, we can obtain this equation for kinetic temperature, which is called by equation for ballistic thermal conductivity by Professor Kirsov. And then we can obtain the analytical solution for describing the slow motion. So you see this is quite complex procedure, but this procedure can be realized for enough complex systems. And what is the aim of my talk? In a previous talk by Alexei Sokolov, Anton Kirsov, and Wolfgang Pummler, these two solutions, I mean the continuum one and the district one, was compared between each other. But I want to do this a little bit better. I want to derive the continuous solution as in the sum asymptotic way based on the discrete solution. So I want to obtain the continuous solution as a slow component of a five field asymptotic to the corresponding exact discrete solution. And the part two of my presentation, in part two, I plan to discuss some perspectives that I see here in this way. So let's start to derive the continuous solution as asymptotics of the discrete solution. This is very easy to do, and I really I really don't understand why nobody did this before. You can see here we have the integral representation for the Bessel function of the integer order, and we want to consider the far field asymptotics on the moving front. Which moves at the constant velocity, but we assume that the number of particle and the time goes to infinity. In this way, we substitute this representation into the representation for the Bessel function. Now we obtain the function of one large variable, I mean the number of the particles, and then we apply the method of the stationary phase. In this way, we see that there are no stationary points in the case then the velocity of the point is greater than one, and in the case then in the case where then the velocity of the front is less than one, there are one stationary point, two stationary points you see here, and then we simply apply the formula describing the contribution from the stationary point to the integral. This is a classical formula from the stationary phase method. The results is written here, and then we substitute this representation for the Bessel function to the formula for kinetic temperature. We need to square the Bessel function, and we need to double n and t. And the final step, we substitute the velocity of the wavefront as ratio of n over t into the last expression. Finally, we obtain such representation for the kinetic temperature. Here we have two components. One component is the slow component, And another one is the fast or oscillating component, and the fast component is proportional to the slow component. And slow component is exactly the continuous solution obtained by Professor Kryvtsov in his previous work. Now we can see the comparison. You see here the in the right side we have time-dependent graphs. In the left side, we have the dependence on the particle number. You can see the discrete solution here. The discrete solution is shown by blue color. The continuous solution, I mean the sum of slow and fast solutions. This is a orange curve, and the only slow motion, continuous solution with only slow motion, this is the green curve. You see here that the slow continuous solution is looks like the spatial average for the discrete solution. Here we can find the first of the perspectives of our approach. We can see here that our asymptotics works everywhere very well, excepting the wavefront. And why our solution is wrong on the wavefront? Because on the wavefront we have the case of the emergent singularities, I mean a stationary point and a boundary of integration interval merge. And to obtain the better approximation of the wavefront, we need to consider the case of emergent singularities in the procedure of the method of stationary phase. And these are conclusions for the part one. The conclusions are as follows. First of all, the continuous solution is formally obtained as a slow component or a spatial average of a far field asymptotic of the corresponding exact discrete solution. The asymptotics is obtained using the stationary phase method on moving fronts. Additionally, we naturally decompose the exact solution as a sum of slow and fast motions. And finally, we assume that the results can be easily generalized for more complicated problems where it is possible to obtain the exact solution in the integral form. And the results of the part one are available now as archive preprint, you can see here. And now part two. How we can apply these results for the more complex system. The first good example of more complex system where we can try to obtain the continuous solution by the approach suggested in the first part is the same hook chain with a defect. A defect is the one mass with alternated value. I mean, in this hook chain, we have all mass are equal to each other, and only one mass is alternated by value delta m. The same problem. We have the same initial conditions and the same parameters of random quantity rho. And I think that solution of for this problem in the integral form can be obtained using the generalized Fourier transform with respect to time. And now this work in progress. And at the second step, the integrals can be estimated on moving fronts using the method of stationary phase. And in this way, we can obtain the generalization of concept of continuous solution for this system. You can see here graphs. There are two different cases. The case where the localized mode of oscillation exists in this system, and the case where there is no localized mode of oscillation. The first case where the localization exists corresponds to the case when additional mass is negative. In this case, we see here the in the center the localized oscillations. You can see here the special distribution of the kinetic temperature. These graphs are obtained by numerical calculation, and you can see here the non-vanished localized oscillations, localized near the defect, and these are some tails which can be, I think, described by means of the continuous solution. Another case, the case of no localization or anti-localization. I say anti-localization because you can see here the oscillations near the defect is almost zero here. This corresponds to the case of positive added mass. In this case, we have zero in the center, and we have two tails, and I think these tails also can be described by some continuous solution. This is unfinished work, which is in progress. And another, the possible application which I want to discuss is some paradoxical results concerning two single direction and two dimensional lattices. And if we consider instead of one dimensional crystal, two dimensional crystal, this was done in paper by Kustin Krivtsov, the following paradoxical result can be obtained that on this green diagonals, these are main diagonals with respect to the point where we supply the heat, the solution becomes singular after some time. These singular directions correspond to so-called line localized primitive waveforms or star-like waves. These structures are discussed in these papers by Slepian, Eisenberg, Stepanenko, and co-authors. These structures emerge due to the contribution into an unstationary solution from the finite set of frequencies where the group velocity is zero. But in the framework of the exact discrete model, the energy is localized on line localized primitive waveforms. It's keep non-singular value. Why do the continuum approach predict singularity? How to fix this? I think we need to consider the case of merging singularities. And then we can obtain the reasonable result. And another final example is the case of heat transfer in inelastic system in a harmonic crystal with suddenly applied point heat source of constant intensity. Here we consider the same square lattice, but we have constant we have a point source of heat. This system can be written as the following system of stochastic ordinary differential equations. This system considered in the recent paper by me and Professor Krivtsov, and also we have the same paradoxical results in the presence of the dissipation. We have two singular directions, which correspond to main diagonals. And also, I think if we consider the procedure taken into account, which takes into account the emergent singularities, and use a very finite at previous step solution to fix to obtain the solution of such problem, then we fix singular results at the main diagonals. These are conclusions. These are conclusions for the first part, and this is new conclusions for the part two. We think that similar technique can be used to obtain the continuous solution for the case of harmonic crystal with defects. And also we think that a similar technique can be used to resolve paradoxical singular results obtained for some problem related to ballistic heat propagation in two-dimensional, three-dimensional lattices. We think that these results are related to the case of merging singularities in the method of stationary phase. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Gavrilov. So we have time for a question. Yes, Dmitry Anatolyevich, please.
Yes, thank you very much, dear professor, for your interesting report. My question will be, so do you see any connection between localized in of temperature with some defect of mass and acoustic localization? Or maybe another part of this equation, in what spectrum do you see this localized? In the acoustic long wave, or maybe in the so high short frequencies, high frequencies when we can speak about the house and temperature? How do you see this connection, acoustic and the temperature localized?
The nature of localization is completely the same. But the details a little bit different, because in a continuous system, the stop band is below the dispersion curve. Here in the hook chain, the stop band is above the dispersion curve. So in the hook chain, we need to introduce the defect with negative mass.
See. You have the situation when our dispersion curves go to the asymptotic to the some boundary frequency at the high, as I understand.
Yes.
So phenomenon we can see in the work by Melker in his work maybe 10 years ago, when he showed that in a chain with some defects, we can see the localizer. But he did not speak about the temperature. He speak only of the acoustic localized. And it was interesting for me because it was no any cutoff frequency. What so here? Thank you.
I may say the following. There are a lot of sources where spectral problems for chains are considered. Many sources. But no non-stationary problems.
And why only non-stationary? I can't understand.
There are many sources where spectral problems are considered, but non-stationary problems somewhere they are discussed. For example, in Kunin's book, in Kasevich's book.
But yes.
We have no final solutions.
Okay, I have to stop this discussion. Thank you very much once again, Professor Gavrilov.